Do not attempt to adjust your screen. Forbes DVD Live is taking over.
Yeah, so we got Lumi D in the building. This is your
yeah,
camera.
Yeah, I'm here.
What's going on?
What's up, camera? I'm good. I'm happy to be here. It's exciting
so far.
We was
on the block. Yeah. You used to be on the other side here.
Yes. I used to have a show on DTF. I do miss it.
What was your favorite guest that you interviewed?
Favorite guest? I can't really honestly remember. I really can't remember.
Let me know your guess was a shit.
No, I had good guess. But Latin artist called
A
Latin artist.
Oh, okay.
He ain't a Latin artist.
I thought you said lion artist.
Oh my god.
Like a lion artist.
This is all on tape. We keeping all this for this.
There was this dude called Cocoyola. It's a weird name. Cocoyola.
I know that.
No, I'm telling you why it was dope. Because at that moment, I didn't really know how popular this dude was. You know, he came on the show, we had him, and like the server crashed. Wow. People just tuned in like crazy.
He was out the loop.
So I was like, oh. Okay, so that was the most standout moment for me in the show.
Shout out to Coca-Cola, her honor.
Coca-Cola. So, I mean, but I had a lot of cool moments, like a whole bunch of, you know, people who are still grinding now, you know. Like, I mean, DTF is dope, and we bring a lot of people who actually, you know, got the shine after. So
your artistry, where the fuck have you been? People want to know, where have you been?
Yes, well, I mean, I've been working. I haven't stopped doing the music thing. I've been overseas traveling, releasing music out there, and now I'm back over here releasing music out here.
So you took your career overseas?
I mean, for a little while, yes. You know, I did drop things here and there over here, mixtapes, things like that. Try to, you know, keep people aware, like I'm still doing this. Uh-huh. But you know, the impact really was overseas for me. You know, I dropped singles. They actually charted. They went somewhere. They sold. You know, I toured a lot, you know. Just last year, I had a big record over there called Dance that did really well. So it's, you know, it was just better for me.
Why do you think it's more love overseas than America?
I mean, I feel like I got the opportunity to really showcase more of what I could do, you know. And it was just, and people like different things, which I would do a record for overseas that I really won't drop over here.
Okay.
So, you know, it's just not so. It's not so critical, even though people still are a little harsh, they can be. But I feel like once they like you, they're more open to listening to what else you got. And they'll give you that chance, which over here is like, you know.
When you first came out, you was like a sensation. Everybody knew who you was. Were you ready for that show?
No, not at all, absolutely not.
So take us through the process. Was your music career a mistake? Was it a dare? Was it a bet?
Or was it, was it like, a bet?
Did you do it and it was like, I'm just gonna put music out and see what happens? Like,
Nah. This was a real live dream for me forever. You know, I've always I started writing poetry from when I was young. Okay. I always wanted to be, you know, rapper, singer. The singing thing came to me with writing poetry.
Okay.
I just started writing songs, and then it was like, all right, I'm a singer. You know, I always listen to Salt and Pepper, MC Light, things like that. You know, I grew up listening to music. I love music, Madonna, all types of music, you know. So it was definitely, it wasn't a gimmick or nothing for me. You know, it was for real.
What I'm saying is that when you went in the studio, was you like, I'm going to put this song out and
No, not at all. I was just recording music, you know. I got with this DJ, that, you know, he pretty much was from my neighborhood.
Uh-huh.
He found out that, you know, I was doing music. I let him hear some stuff. He was like, yo, you dope. Went to his house. He had the turntables. I recorded over a mic. He just started playing it in the clubs. And it was like people just took a liking to it.
Okay.
It was sounding dope in the clubs. People started requesting things. And after that, he would play everything in the clubs. And I was kind of like a little local celebrity. Okay. You know what I mean? So it was like people knew the music already. And then when the Uh-Oh came out and we did that, it wasn't even expected. We was just like, this is another joint that's gonna ring in the clubs when he's playing, you know? But it took on a life of its own, and people just started requesting it on the radio. The DJ started asking for it, you know, and it just took off. But I really wasn't, this was all in like a time span of a year of me just learning how to record. I didn't know how to really perform yet. I didn't know nothing about the business. So it took me like,
And we did another interview on my block that I'm going to put out. But you was chunky at the time.
Yeah.
And explain to them why.
Shout out to all my big girls.
Yeah. No, yes. I mean, fat girls will always be in. You know why?
Yes.
Because they always give head.
Oh, what?
And they got food in their house.
Oh, wow.
And it's about to get cold. Am I lying?
Oof. Yeah. I mean, those are things that, those things that men like, you know.
Yes. But you wasn't.
No, I wasn't naturally big girl.
Yeah.
You know, when I was 14, I got this thing called rheumatoid arthritis.
Okay.
So I was on prednisone.
Okay.
Prednisone, if anybody knows, is a steroid. Mm-hmm. It swells you up.
Okay.
So there was no pump the brakes on your health because you about to pop off. It's like, yo, this is happening. Video, this, that. And I was in the middle of being on steroids, you know? So that's what it was. That's why I had the chubby cheeks. And I was a little younger. So, you know, it just looked like baby fat, you know, and afterwards I immediately had to get off of it because I seen it for myself, and it was like everybody was saying I was big, and it was like it really fucked with me.
What was the hate like?
It really fucked with me. I mean, oh, she's fat, she's everything, all types. I got everything.
You're pretty for a fat girl.
Yeah, like, oh, she's cute, but she got a big head, or she's this, or she's that. It was all. Oh, I got everything. They call me lollipop head.
Damn.
The Latin lollipop.
Yeah,
it was cool though. It was like, I mean, at the time I was like, yo, this shit is a lot. It was a lot to take, you know. It was just too much attention. It was too much. But hey, you know, whatever. Shit happened.
Was it a point where you wanted to quit?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. I mean, and not just because of that, because at the end of the day, I mean, I'm a tough girl. So it was like, I knew what I was, I know what I'm about, but I wanted to quit because the people I came in with, it wasn't a real thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's like we built this thing together, and it was like they just wanted it. You know, once you start asking questions, people don't like that.
Yeah. Once you learn.
Yeah, and it's like I'm started asking questions, and that became a problem. And all of a sudden, because I was asking questions, I was a monster. So I'm like, I'm a monster because I want to know how much I get paid to show.
Yeah.
That type of shit, crazy shit. Like,
so you didn't know those things.
Yeah, I was doing shows not knowing what I got paid. I just know what they gave me. And then out of that, I had to pay everybody else. It was crazy shit like that.
So, what did you make a lot of money in the business off that record?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I could have made more if my lawyer game was right.
Oh shit!
You know, because I wrote the record, but it was just
Do you everything own the was record great. To this day?
Do I own it?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't own it completely. No, I own a piece.
Okay.
You know, I have a piece of publishing on it. But honestly, I can't complain. The checks still come in, and I got a small part.
I want to educate, you know, the people that's coming up.
Yeah.
What was the first big check you got? How much was it?
The first big check I got was $100,000.
Oh shit!
Yeah. Love it.
Yeah.
And what did you do with the money?
Got a car.
A hoopty or some shit?
Nah, some shit.
Yeah, okay.
Everybody's telling me got a hoopty. I'm like, but why? What the fuck you talking about? Like, but it was some shit. You know, it was a Yukon Denali truck.
Oh shit, that shit still pop.
For me, that was, you know, that was the shit. And I love trucks. You know, I always was like, if I was to get money, I want a truck. But the crazy shit is that I don't drive, so I always have somebody driving.
So at what point did you move out of Spanish Hall?
Yeah, after I got that check, like, I stood where I was at for a little while, but it was like people just knew where I was at, pointing at my window. It was just too much. It was too much attention, so I knew, all right, I had to get out, and, you know, just went over the bridge to Jersey.
Was it a moment where you were too famous for the hood?
At a moment, yeah. I stopped going back because it felt really weird. It didn't feel good. Like, people think you, like, people feel like, oh, you want that attention. You know, like artists like that shit. Yeah. People like to go out to eat,
and
you like to go to the supermarket and not have to get done up. You like to just feel regular, and especially around the people that you grew up around and that know you. But when they start treating you like they can't believe that you're there, they all over you. They want to take 1,000 pictures. They don't, and you're like, what the fuck, yo? But you like. You didn't give a fuck about me,
yeah.
You know, a few weeks ago, and now it's so, you know, and you do it, you take the pictures, you be polite, but then it's like, it gets a little too much.
Yeah. What's one of the biggest misconceptions that you hear about you that you want to, like, that is untrue, 100%?
Untrue. It's a lot of things. I'm not going to focus on the big girl shit because I don't want to alienate my big girls.
Okay.
So, I'll just say, the one hit wonder thing.
Okay.
You know, that I'm only capable of doing one good record,
okay,
that's bullshit, you know, because I mean, if I could do one, I could do another.
Yeah.
So it doesn't mean it's going to be the same, but I'm definitely about making music. That's what I do.
Did you turn down any deals and situations around that time?
Yeah, there was a bidding war when we came out with Uh-Oh, so there was a lot of different, you know, labels coming at us. And for instance, I didn't know I was signing to Universal till I walked in the building. I thought I was in Arista.
Wow.
You know, I thought I was signing to LA Reid because I met with him and everything. And I walked in the building. They were like, yo, you're going to sign the contract. Come over here to this address. At this time, I really wasn't even going downtown like that. So I don't even know what the Universal building was. I walked in. I was like, so there's Arista? They're like, no. Security was like, you're in Universal. Like, all right.
Yeah.
I called the people that I was signed to. You know, it was like I was signed to an independent
production deal.
Yeah, production deal. Okay. So they were like, nah, change of plans. It's a bigger, you know, more money here. We signing here. And that was it.
Did you ever drop an album?
Yeah. I dropped 2 albums. Well, at that time, Almost Famous came out.
Okay.
And everything just went sour after Uh-Oh, because it was just, I think it was so big. People didn't know how to handle all that immediate fame and money, you know, and people just changed up and switched up and everybody just broke up. You know, like the whole team broke up. So I was like on my own trying to learn the business and I didn't really know what to do at that point, but I figured it out.
ForbesDVD.com.